Okay, so thank you for the opportunity to present some of the work we have been doing the last years. So I will turn the perspective below ground and talk about the importance of mycorrhizal fungi in the northern coniferous forests and some words about ectomycorrhizals and forestry as well. So the boreal forests, they cover one third of the Earth's forest area, and they cover the areas of North America, Canada, Alaska, and then Scotland, Iceland, Scandinavia, Finland, Russia, and also Asian countries such as Kazakhstan, Mongolia, and Japan. And typical for these forests is a relatively short growing season, quite acidic soil, and really slow decomposition of organic matter and low nitrogen availability. And the major tree species are pine, spruce, birch, and larch. And these are all ectomycorrhizal tree species. And in boreal forests, only few tree species support the huge diversity of soil microbes, including thousands of ectomycorrhizal fungal species. So with mycorrhiza, we mean the symbiotic structure between a fungus and a root of a vascular plant. And through roots, plants are linked to the huge diversity of microbes and other organisms in the rhizosphere. Mycorrhizas enhance the root surface area and thus also the supply of nutrients and water. The fungal mycelia grow inside the humus and the upper mineral soil layers and is able to penetrate much smaller pores than roots. Fungi also are connected to each other, making this common mycorrhizal network that then connect different plants and different fungal species to one network. The ectomycorrhizal association is really common on coniferous trees. The ectomycorrhizal fungi colonizes the root tissues externally by surrounding the root tip with a thick mantle of closely pressed hyphae. And it's shown in blue, the fungal part. There's also several other types of mycorrhizas. One quite common on trees, broadleaf trees in temperate regions, is the arbuscular mycorrhiza. And it's also a really common mycorrhizal type of crop plants and annual grasses. And in the arbuscular mycorrhizas, the fungal colonization is intracellular. And you can see it in pink color. So the mycorrhizas are really essential for terrestrial life, and the co-evolution between ectomycorrhizal fungi and the Pinaceae family goes way back, more than 100 million years ago. The ectomycorrhizal fungi are key organisms in boreal soil ecosystem processes, and they enable acquisition of major growth-limiting nutrients, such as phosphorus and nitrogen, and water in many natural ecosystems. They also may protect trees against various abiotic stresses and even root pathogens. The external mycelia expand the volume of roots by thousands of times, and the ectomycorrhizal fungal mycelia can comprise up to one third of the whole microbial biomass in coniferous soil. And this is a nice graph where you see the seedling and the root system and all the quite hyphae is the fungi. So you can see that it's really expanding the contact area with soil. Also, the carbon sequestration changed with the ectomycorrhizal as a fungal community shifts during long-term succession in boreal forests. And these are quite recent studies done in Sweden. And Clemensen et al. Found that in young forests, the really common and typical ectomycorrhizal fungal species such as Cortinarius and Suivus are really abundant. There is a rapid turnover of mycelial biomass and necromass, and there's a really efficient nitrogen mobilization and low carbon sequestration. But in old forests, the fungal communities are dominated by this kind of shrub mycorrhizas, ericoid mycorrhizas, which are asphomycetes and which facilitate long-term humus buildup as the hyphae is really black and melanized and it can resist decomposition. Another Swedish study found that ectomycorrhizal fungi are critical in litter decomposition. So they are not saprotrophic fungi, so they don't use litter as a source of carbon. They get carbon from the host plants. But still, as the ectomycorrhizal fungi access the host sugars, that facilitates a co-metabolic degradation of complex and recalcitrant organic complexes that increase the nitrogen mobilization by releasing nitrogen from organic pools and influence organic matter storage in soil. They also mediate responses of ecosystem carbon sequestration to environmental changes. Ectomycorrhizal fungi have a limited capacity to decompose plant litter, and many ectomycorrhizal fungal species have lost the glucoside hydrolysis and peroxidases. But one really abundant genera, the Cortinarius, it's safety in Finnish, they have a large number of peroxidase genes, which enzymatically oxidize and decompose phenolic macromolecules, such as lignin and less specified humic complexes. And by that, they facilitate humus decomposition. The peroxidase activity in soils correlates positively with ectomycorrhizal fungal species richness and abundance. So I have been working with Norway spruce now for 8 years, and it's commercially the most important tree species in Finland, and 100 million seedlings are planted yearly. So after a clear cut in Finland, most forest owners buy their seedlings from the forest nursery and plant the seedlings to the clear cut area. But still, the mortality after planting is quite high. There's a lot of reasons, but one of the issues we have been studying is to increase the vitality of the seedlings and also to balance the proportion of shoot and root size. Because seedlings which are big, have big shoots and are green, sell well, but those seedlings that have shorter stems and bigger below ground root systems survive better after planting. One of the first findings relating to ectomycorrhizal fungi and Norway spruce was that our group found that in these kind of plantations with different spruce genotypes, when you went to collect samples from a really well-growing stand with a really well-growing genotype, you could find a lot higher diversity of ectomycorrhizal fungi connected to the roots, and also ectomycorrhizal fungi that produce a lot of external hyphae. And in comparison, when you went to sample a clone that didn't grow that well, that was a slow-growing clone, there were much less ectomycorrhizal fungal species in the roots. So the question was that, are these things related somehow, and could these be used in the seedling production? So the aim has been to improve the quality of containerized spruce seedlings, and also to investigate the usage of ectomycorrhizal fungi as an integrated pest management in forest nurseries, and also to study the specificity of the mycorrhizal interaction by assessing the effects of host genotypic variation on the ectomycorrhizal symbiosis. So the first studies were conducted by the group leader, Taina Pennanen, and others. And they were making surveys, collecting samples from the forest nurseries to see what's there. And they sampled 1-year-old seedlings, spruce seedlings, and 2-year-old spruce seedlings in 5 different nurseries. And then they analyzed the colonization level. It's shown here, and different colors and paintings show different species. So during the first years in nursery 1, there were no ectomycorrhizal fungal colonization, and the same holds for nursery 5, but in others there were 2 to 3 species found attached as in association with Norway spruce. After 2 years, there were much more different species found in the roots, but still in 2 nurseries there were almost no colonization. In one of the nurseries, the ectomycorrhizal colonization is over 60, and in nature it's something close to 90. So in some forest nurseries, the ectomycorrhizal colonization is really already on a quite good level. And the major findings between from these 2 studies was that these nurseries who use a lot of mineral nutrients and use them in really early season, they lose the naturally spore, these mycorrhizas that come by spore. And these nurseries that use much less fertilizers and also use fertilizers only in the late season, they can gain quite nice combination of mycorrhizas. So the main conclusion was that it could be wise to reduce the use of inorganic fertilizations and also review the nursery practices, so the fertilization is given a little bit later for young seedlings. We could also see from these studies that root size is correlated with the nitrogen load. So these nurseries that used less nitrogen had a more balanced root-to-shoot ratio. So it's also beneficial for the seedling size or the root size to use a little bit less nitrogen. Then few other studies were conducted to see how different species of ectomycorrhizal fungi affect the growth in the field. So over 50 ectomycorrhizal fungal strains were isolated during a few years. It's quite difficult to isolate and grow these fungi in plates because they are not saprotrophs, so they are not happy with only some mold agar. So you really need to put a lot of effort to isolate them. And most strains were isolated from this kind of harsh environment, so sandy slopes, roadsides. And more than 1,000 seedlings were inoculated with single strains and then outplanted. And we could see that this blue and this orange bar shows only like normal fertilization. So this is high fertilization and this is a little bit reduced fertilization. And you can see that this is the shoot height of seedlings after 2 years after outplanting, so growing 2 years in the field. And there's a lot of strains that actually improve the growth more than the conventional fertilization. And especially it's quite striking that there's a lot of atelier species that really improve the growth. And these atelier species are quite commonly found in decaying woodlogs and also like decay stage 5, that's almost totally decayed. And also, if you go into natural forest site and you see a really decomposed log and you already see spruce seedlings growing from that and you sample those mycorrhizas, they are dissimilar atelier, so Tylosphora and Pyloderma and this type of fungi. So we were really happy to find out that we could isolate these fungi and some of these strains really improved the growth of spruce seedlings in the field.
Couple of minutes left.
Okay. Yes. So then we have also conducted some studies how the forestry practices affect the ectomycorrhizal communities. So in Finland it's quite common to do a clear cut and then mounding, and even after the mounding you might do stump removal. But it seems that the clear cut affects the fungal communities a lot, so all the old forest species are gone. But after the clear cut, the mounding is not making a too big difference. So even though you move the stumps, you don't mess up with the fungal communities that much. So the biggest difference is natural forest and clear cut. We have also published a few studies by using ectomycorrhizal fungi for integrated pest management. So root rot, Heterobasidon root rot, is the most severe pathogen, especially on spruce. And we have made some successful studies using some ectomycorrhizal fungi to protect seedlings in vitro against Heterobasidon, Anosum and Parviporum. Then we have also made studies by seeing the specificity of the symbiosis, and it seems that you can inoculate any ectomycorrhizal fungi that's suitable for spruce into any seedling, but the abundances and the communities vary a lot. So this was a population of 55 genotypes of Norway spruce, and they were all able to make symbiosis with all provided strains. And then in another study, we wanted to see if there's differences between differently growing spruces. So if a spruce is from a fast-growing family, it can equally take all the fungi, and the same with the slowly growing origins. But the growth allocation is a little bit different. So it seems that the increasing richness of fungi shifts the biomass allocation towards roots in the fast-growing families. So they invest in the early stages more below ground and get a good, nice root system. So to conclude, good nursery practices are really important for forestry. The ectomycorrhizal colonization leads to larger root to shoot ratio and thus a much higher seedling quality. These seedlings are more suitable for planting machines, and seedlings are much more likely to survive and grow well after outplanting. We can also potentially use some ectomycorrhizal fungal isolates to promote seedling growth in the field. The high ectomycorrhizal fungal diversity in the field seems to be rather an effect than a cause of the fast growth of the host tree. And the ectomycorrhizal fungal diversity enhances the nutrient uptake potential. And furthermore, some of these strains may have the potential to protect seedlings against root pathogens. And then I want to announce a congress next summer, so you're all welcome. Thank you.
In the previous presentation, we heard that there is sexual life between two fungus species, and now we know that there is also cooperation between plants and fungus. So please continue on this topic or some other questions related to this presentation.
Thanks for a lot of new information about the mycorrhizae. Is anything known about the chemical signaling between the mycorrhizae and the trees and the roots?
Yes, actually there's quite a lot of studies done in France.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of signaling going on, and a lot of proteins. There's even proteins going from one organism to the inside cells in the other organism.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's really well known at the moment, yes.
I will pick up some references from
yes,
you. Thank you.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Thanks.
Vielä tulisi yksi kysymys.
Some of ectomycorrhizal fungi are known to be stone eaters, and I think at least one of these ateliotes, this Piloderma, uses some minerals from mineral soils and stones.
We measured some correlations with the silicon content.
I'm afraid I don't have this knowledge, but I think that you can find publications. I think Roger Finley has at least been publishing from this.
There's still one more question.
Why planting of seedlings is preferred to natural herb regeneration?
I think I need to ask Han. Can you answer this?
It's much more cost effective. You can use the breeding effect, for example, so that you can increase the growth of the seedlings by 20-30%, and also the total costs of the regeneration actually are lower in this, because you can reduce the time for the new generation of all the trees.
Yeah, and one other reason is probably that we don't have that much spruce seeds in Finland, so we are already importing some of the seeds from Sweden. So I think this is probably also one way to avoid kind of using all seeds which we have.